Jesus. Not one coming for salvation, but one that's soon to return, bringing judgment.
Jesus.
Go, oh, glory.
Amen.
And here, can you imagine at the foot of the Mount of Transfiguration? I'm sure some faces got transfigured as well. Them three disciples out there at the bottom of that mountain, Peter being the leading one of them, looks up and sees it. Jesus is praying. Can you imagine that? His garments became white and glistening. The glory of God came on him like John saw. His hair was turned like fire in his eye. Man, the Bible said in verses 31, or verses 30, that appeared alongside of Jesus was two other men, Elias and Moses. Or Elijah and Moses. But Elijah was caught up in a fiery chariot. But a fiery chariot up in the heaven. He didn't die. Somebody say he was raptured or something.
Amen.
But Moses was not raptured. Moses died. So this is an image prophetically of a risen Christ that's coming again. Even before he was ever crucified and buried and raised from the dead, he was given a revelation that those who are dead in Christ will be caught up first. That those who are alive and remain when I come will be caught up also together.
Amen. Pray for him.
He appeared in his glory, Pastor. And in Luke 9:31, here was the story of his glory. He spake to Moses and Elijah about his deceasing, about his dying on the cross that was about to take place. He spake of how he was going to be turned over into the hands of sinful men and be crucified by the religious leaders of his day, and 3 days later be raised from the dead. And somebody shouted, his glory showed up. Before he ever hung on the cross, was buried in the tomb, and before he was ever raised from the dead by the glory of God the Father, according to Romans 6:4, because it was the glory. Someone said the glory of God the Father raised Jesus from the dead. That's Romans 6:4. Somebody shout, it was the Father's glory that raised Jesus up. And God's given three disciples an image, a portrait before it ever happened. And all people can say, my God, let's build this 3 hours. Three tabernacles here. One for Moses, one for Elijah, and one for Jesus. Oh, dumb Peter. I got to pull a Fred Sanford out on that one here. You mean dumb? Somebody shout. Because the cloud of God's glory, the same cloud that you saw in the book of Exodus,
associated with it. Preacher, you want to get the quickest downfall to your ministry?
Somebody say Jesus won't share his glory with her. Man made tradition. You know, in John 2:13, this is the beginning of Jesus' ministry. He's about 30 years of age. He cleanses the temple. We think the cleansing of the temple was just one event toward the end of his ministry. He cleaned house to the point where the whip in his hand wasn't it for Jesus and what a lot of modern church parishioners are used to. Come on. One walking in with a whip in his hand, driving folk out. Somebody shout, are you going to get Jesus in the house?
Amen.
You don't have some folk off. So if all you're trying to do is keep everybody in harmony and don't want to offend nobody, you probably told Jesus to get out.
Amen. Amen.
But in the beginning of his ministry, he also cleansed the temple. John chapter 2 is recorded. Because in verse 13 it said, and the feast of the Jews was now, and Jesus went up unto Jerusalem. Somebody shout, the Jews feast. The Jews Passover. Well, I thought Exodus 12, 27 said it was the Lord's Passover. It was. The third time. A degrading of the truth. Come on, somebody. Deviating from raw truth. Adding a little bit here and there, associating something with him, sharing his glory. Jesus gets lost in the midst of it. Oh, he's still talked about. But he's just one of the things that goes on.
Yes.
Not the thing.
Yes.
Hello?
Amen.
So you better say amen when you can, because you won't have trouble. A lot of people think I just take my Lord a little too far. You're right, I do. One day it'll take me a little far. Right on this word. I'm extreme about a radical Jesus. You know, radical in that word of God means someone who is given to, who advocates fundamental and extreme changes. Somebody shout, Jesus is that radical. He advocates extreme changes. You can't really meet him and say who you are. If you're the same person you are, and you say you've made him, you ain't made it. Because he's radical. He's so radical, he walked in Jerusalem, took the whip out, cleaned the house, run sin out, come on somebody, and then kill him for it. Some preachers now, they come on somebody that's so secret friendly, hallelujah, and don't want to offend nobody. All in the name, come on somebody, embrace and love. Hello. some things in there. See, Satan's greatest deception in these last days is not a completely doing away with the truth. Satan is, I call, the mixing God. He gives you enough of truth. And at slow times, he interjects small little statements of error. He'll preach stuff to you that's half right. He'll preach to you, listen, the devil. He'll preach to you about Jesus dying on the cross for your sins. He'll preach about the blood. He'll talk about his amazing grace. And he'll tell you how great he loves you. Come on, somebody. But he don't take it no further than that. Come on, somebody. He'll read to you the rough letters in Scripture about for God so loved this world that he gave his only begotten Son that whoever believes in him shall have everlasting life. For God so loved you. He loved the world. Somebody shout, that's the truth.
See you.
just doing harm to the temple of God, go over eating this too, so before you shout. Does your neighbor say, thou shalt not have a belly god? Anyhow, that's another message, but I had to say it. Where was I? Oh, I've done read all of them. I was in John 2:13. It was no longer the Lord's Passover. They were turning it the Jews' Passover. Somebody shout, they lost Jesus in the midst of their tradition. They lost him out at the temple like Mary and Joseph did. Jesus got mad. Jesus walked in there with a holy indignation and anger. Tore the house up. Wouldn't you like to invite a living Jesus walking around on earth today over to your religious convention? Jesus was not the necessarily church growth personality you want to have Jesus. He walks up to the pulpit and said, my house should be called a house of prayer. But you made it a den of thieves. Matthew 21:13 called them a bunch of robbers and then run them out.
Amen.
But in verse 14 of Matthew 21, after he run the religious hypocrites out, tight-fisted religious hypocrites.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. He run them out, then the sick and the lame come to him in verse 14 of Matthew 21, and they got healed.
Amen.
See, y'all think I'm just preaching something hard, but no, tonight people's going to get healed. This hard word of preaching is the key to restoring the miracles back to his church.
Yes. Glory.
Because tradition that's modern within the Christian so-called community has given me a puny Jesus. Give me a featured, effeminate looking Jesus as most members do. Just a lovey-dovey Jesus. Winks at everything because he don't say nothing. He's just allowing it to pass on. That's the image a lot of people's got in today in modern Christianity. They don't see this Jesus tearing up the temple, cleansing and seeing out. Because a lot of people want that kind of Jesus in the church, but then they've wondered, where did his wonders go? You can't have only that image of Jesus and have miracles in the church. If somebody ain't telling people, warning them about eternity, call somebody and tell them you got to leave your sin. You got to turn from it, repent of it, and believe more. Even Jesus in Mark 1:15, his first message was repent, believe the gospel. But Jesus, you hadn't even believed if you hadn't repented.
Yeah.
Glory to God.
Jesus walked in and said, you want to have truth or you want to continue to be a thief? Somebody shouted, run religious folks out, but got people healed.
Yes, amen.
Became the Jews' Passover. They were associating the Lord's Passover tradition with other things. The religious leaders were exchanging money. Hello? At the temple entrance. I ain't got time to go into the details of all that, but they were making a good profit. They were nothing but prophets of profit. Kind of like when I went to Africa one time, I had to exchange our currency for theirs, and when I come back home, I still had some of their money, and I lost money. Because ours was worth more than theirs. But in America, that ain't going to be too much longer. But listen, that's why you've got to lay your treasures up in the kingdom of God like you did this morning when your pastor spoke. Listen to this. They were making pretty good prophet, these prophets and prophets. They were robbing God of his glory also. His house during the Passover feast was supposed to be about him. Somebody say him only.
Him only.
Sadly, a singular thing is happening today within modern Christianity. course, there's not the exchanging of the ancient money changers sitting at the temple door saying, you've got to give us money to get in. And I said, thank God. Well, there'd be a lot of times. Amen. Yet there's still some worldly merchandising taking place within the modern church during Passover, or what we refer to as Easter season. Somebody said the exchanging is truth for fables. 2 Timothy 4:4 says they turned their ears from the truth and were turned into fables. Someone shouts, you can't embrace fables and truth without rejecting one or the other. You can be a truth seeker and embrace fables and excuse it with your opinionated idea. I'm not talking about any tradition, I'm talking about pagan ones. Because there's some traditions that's good within the modern church. Come on, Scott. I'm not preaching against all traditions. But your neighbor said, if you didn't say amen about 5 minutes ago, you probably won't be able to say it much more yet. Easter is a season of merchandise for the world. I might say for the world. It really is. It's advertised along with Peter Cottontail hopping down a bunny trail. I don't know about it. Easter egg hunts. Some folks has went out and broke their pocketbook and bank account trying to find something new to wear for this day. Boy, I'm telling you, it's a big merchandise out. Almost like Christmas. Well, I'm going on Target. I'm already, I ain't even said nothing yet. I feel people squirming.